This video unit should not be thought of as representing formal research and development economics. Rather, they are my own, Tyler's, thoughts on education. Please treat this as speculative. Consider the case of Sweden. Today, Sweden is a wealthy country and also a well-ordered country. It is successful by many metrics. Yet if we go back in time, looking back through human history, Sweden was not in all periods of time a very wealthy country. It often had famines. And Swedish resources, they have some, but the resources are not impressive enough to account for Swedish economic growth. There's a sense in which the development of Sweden is virtually coeval with Swedish educational development. That is, Swedish success is based on human capital, and it's based on a certain sense of rules of just conduct. The thing is, when you look at Sweden, it's quite difficult to disentangle which of these habits and norms and practices can be thought of as education in the narrow sense, and which are simply part of the broader Swedish code of success. In one sense, you can think of good education as a kind of symptom of Swedish success. So once Sweden has some cooperative and useful social practices and a high degree of conscientiousness, individual Swedes, due to cultural influences, are simply very strongly impelled to become educated. The education itself may not be the causal factor. The education itself, viewed alone, may in some ways seem relatively unimportant, but when the education is viewed as part of this broader bundle of cultural good practices, the broader bundle then seems extremely important. It's the single item which is really setting Sweden apart. Consider the following thought experiment. Take a Swede, make that Swede extremely well educated, say give him or her a PhD in economics, and put that Swede down in a rural village in an extremely poor country with virtually no infrastructure. How much is that education worth? Well, it's probably not worth very much. Being able to do econometrics in a village which has no electricity and no computers and perhaps no paper and no writing implements, it's simply not worth much in terms of marginal return. We again see that the education taken alone with nothing else going right in a society maybe simply isn't worth very much. But again, if we go back to this notion of thinking in terms of the broader bundle, the education plus the infrastructure plus the electricity plus the communications, then the education is indeed very powerful. So whenever we're thinking about education, there are always at least two perspectives. One is the education simply taken alone, and the other is education as part of some broader cultural bundle or as part of some broader bundle of good infrastructure and good communications. And education can look correspondingly more productive or less productive, simply depending upon how you frame the question and how you think about the relevant bundles in these societies. The trick, perhaps, is to be aware of these possible shifts in perspective and have the appropriate degree of skepticism, but also the appropriate understanding of seeing a valuable contribution, and realize that many writings in the field undervalue education because they're framing the bundling in the wrong way, and many other writings in the field are overvaluing education, again, because they're attributing all of the benefits of these broader bundles simply to education alone. We tend to see a lot of private schooling when social capital is low. Examples of this would be rural India and also rural Haiti, where in many instances, large numbers of poor students attend private schools. These schools are low-fee schools. They tend to have a large number of teachers, and their education is certainly better than the alternative of nothing, or maybe public schools where the teachers don't show up, but typically they are not the highest quality schools in those countries. That's because when you view them as embedded in this framework, the fact that private schools are necessary means that you're operating in a particular regional framework of relatively low trust and relatively low social capital. In regions where social capital is stronger, such as Northern Europe, most education tends to be supplied by the public sector. At the primary and secondary levels, this education tends to be quite strong, but it's a mistake to make direct comparisons of public sector educational provision and private sector educational provision. A larger role for the public sector is often symptomatic of this broad bundle where most of society, including government and including voters, are indeed somewhat obsessed with providing education, and that often means it will be done through the state. In very broad terms, we've ended up with a global setting where private schools are supplying a lot of the very poorest people in the market, and private schools, in the form of higher education in the United States, are also supplying education to the very wealthiest and best educated people in the market. Consider Harvard, Princeton, Yale, Stanford, and many other places. Public sector education seems to do best fitting in at that middle level in countries where there's a fairly high degree of conscientiousness and social norms stressing the importance of education. Private sector schools such as Harvard are either leaping over what the public sector can do, or the poorer private sector primary schools in India and Haiti are basically stepping in and making up for gaps where social order in certain ways is not high enough to lead to effective public provision of education. In my view, the problem of economic development is, in some fundamental way, actually nearly synonymous with the problem of education, but to understand that, we need to interpret education quite broadly as a kind of inculcation of the appropriate social practices, trust, willingness to cooperate, and aspiration to become wealthy and to be part of an economically successful nation. Education is a question of building in enough presuppositions to support modern civilization and advanced capitalism, and these presuppositions should be believed as general rules, even though in many particular instances they may be false or they may be delusions. This again means that we need to accept certain educational and social norms as a kind of absolute and adhere to them rather more rigidly than perhaps the data themselves would indicate. We need to take education, which is simply part of this broader practice, this broader bundle of good social norms, and elevate it to an extreme importance. In other words, we need to embrace education not only as a cause of progress, but as a symptom of progress, and to treat the role of education as a symptom of progress as perhaps equally or more important than the role of education as a cause of process. So to go back to Michael Kramer's O-ring model, if you think of economic development as requiring 10, 20, or maybe 30 different things to go right, education is one of those things. When you have only education, but you're this educated PhD with a degree in economics from somewhere in Sweden and you're in a poor village, well, education isn't worth much. But if you have all the other pieces of the puzzle, if you have good infrastructure and you have good communications facilities, but your society is not very well educated, well, you're somewhat wealthier, but you're still lacking in the ability to compete at a world-class level in a lot of sectors. Perhaps the final lesson is that education in some ways works best when people believe in it as a matter of faith and when people invest in it as a matter of faith. This is inconsistent with a scientific or economic perspective, which is always trying to ask, what is the marginal rate of return of investing more in education or something else? It's being able to reconcile these two perspectives and see that each contains and reveals some fundamental truths about education that is perhaps part of the wisdom of developing a broader appreciation of the role of education in economic development. Again, I stress these are my personal thoughts and they should be considered quite speculative.